ॐ शंखं चक्रं जलौकां दधतमृतघटं चारु दोर्भिश्चतुर्भिः सूक्ष्मस्वच्छाति हृद्यांशुक परिविलसन् मौलिमम्भोजनेत्रं कालाम्भोदोज्ज्वलांगं कटितटविलसच्चारुपीताम्बराढ्यं वंदे धन्वंतरिं तं निखिलगदवनप्रौढदावाग्निनीलम्।
इज डॉक्टर कीर्ति लड्डा। कीर्ति लड्डा इज बेसिकली फ्रॉम फार्माकोग्नोसी बैकग्राउंड। ही इज डीन आईसीटी एंड प्रोफेसर ऑफ फार्माकोग्नोसी फ्रॉम मुंबई। ही हैज अ वास्ट एक्सपीरियंस इन द फील्ड ऑफ फार्माकोग्नोसी। इन फैक्ट फॉर पास्ट टू डेज on 5th and 6th we had done a separate workshop, a focused workshop on quality assurance training at a local college, a VNS college, where Dr. Ladda conducted the entire seminar. He has various publications to his record, and his main field of interest and working is on phytoconstituents. He has numerous publications, 72 numbers in total. He has about 7 PhD students who have completed, 43 master students who have completed MPharm. Then currently he has 10 PhD students with him working right now and 5 master students. He has worked on about 15 sponsored projects from governments such as AICT, UGC, ICAR, AYUSH, ICMR. And about 10 industry projects from various companies such as Gufic, Colgate Palmolive, Kukadeshwar, Vedic Life Sciences, Nandan Biotech, Genome Biotech, Nisarga Biotech. He has also done industrial consultancy with companies like Asil Herbals, Pristine Agriculture, Charak Pharma, Yuka Enterprises, etc. I now call upon him to deliver his talk, which is on concept of GLP.
Good afternoon to everyone. And before I really get into the subject matter, let me just talk to you about the last 2 days, what we did. And for the last couple of days, we are running workshop actually at a VNS College of the VNS Institutes. And the workshop is pertaining to the hands-on training on the various laboratory processes or the methods which have normally been followed for the evaluation of the raw material and in some cases finished product as well. And the workshop, of course, it was attended by around 30 plus people who came from the India, or sorry, who came from the Ayurvedic field from all over the India. And what we try to do actually is to expose them to the basic technique, which of course it was too short period for them to give a in-depth training, but what we could do actually to expose them to the training so that they should feel confident and practice it at their level. Now when I let's get into the field about Ayurveda. In fact, some of the things are repetitive, so I'll repeatedly skip it. I'll come to the core thing, the need for the analysis, and thereafter I'll get into the GLP. Let me first get into when we talk about the analysis. And of course in India we are still in fact accepting few cases which are, I'll put it actually, the well-organized activity or the well-organized company. By and large, analysis of the raw material or for that the finished product is of course a big question mark. And let me talk about the issues actually, why it is so and why there is a necessity for the evaluation. Now we have a lot of problem associated with the herbal product. Now the major issue with which we are battling today is cultivation. We all know whatever we are using the herbal drugs, those are not coming only from the cultivation, but majority of them are coming from the wild source on which we have no control. Control in the sense we cannot guarantee the uniformity of the constituents which are eventually or the ultimately responsible for the action of it. And with the result, yes, there is a need actually for the cultivation. And since it does not guarantee the uniformity from the wild product, there is a need for the cultivation, and there is a need that more and more drugs should get into the cultivation segment rather than to come from the wild source. Standardization is another issue, which many of ingredients what we are using today, we don't have the analytical profile being well established throughout the country. In fact, various pharmacopoeias has come, whether it is from the ICMR or whether it is from the IUSH or whether it is from the other agencies, various pharmacopoeias are there, but we don't have a single pharmacopoeia which is uniform and which the country can follow uniformly. And with the result, there is a disparity in the level, the standards which have been let down, and the time has come actually that we must have one single uniform monograph or the single uniform pharmacopoeia to be followed, so that there will be uniformity as regard to the analysis what we carried out. Isolating new leads, in fact, I have seen current pharmacopoeia of 2010. The government of India has included quite a few herbal monographs in that. And this very nice monograph where the HPLC has been given for the monograph to be followed. But merely giving the HPLC does not solve the problem. What about making the phytoconstants available to undertake this kind of analysis? And government of India, as in today, does not have any mechanism by which they can make this phytoconstants available for the routine analysis. So giving HPLC analysis or the giving HPLC profile in the monograph really does not solve the problem, unless the government also comes out with the phytoconstituent at the reasonable cost by which industry feel comfortable, buy it and use it. So certainly there is a need actually that whenever we enforce or whenever we come out with a monograph, whether it is a calorimetric analysis or whether it is a HPLC analysis, it is mandatory requirement of the government actually they must also come out with a phytoconstituent, so that at the reasonable cost, then only this monograph preparation and the inclusion of the HPLC as an analytical method will really do the justice to that. Unless they do this, whatever number of pharmacopoeia they come out with the HPLC, I am sure actually it is not going to make any impact. Developing analytical protocol, we don't have, as I told you, in fact, 2010 itself, the analytical profile has come. But that only gives about the raw material. What about the finished product? We have no analytical protocol being devised actually for the finished product. Every finished product has a different combination, and the major problem associated with the Ayurvedic or the herbal raw material and the finished product is that it is not a single ingredient, but it is a multi-ingredient preparation. And not only multi-ingredient preparation, but then the ingredients are from the different complex categories will ultimately make the entire material very complex. And the whole process, sample preparation is more important than the sample analysis. Sample preparation is more important than the sample analysis, but it's very essential that you need to understand what you want to analyze. And if you don't know what to analyze, certainly you will not be able to make the solution or the preparation for the analysis for that. And it is very essential that you should know what you want to analyze. And many a times you have the constituent or the herbal product where you have a two set of the constituent or sometimes more than two set of the constituents, then certainly the question arises, what do you want to analyze in that? Phytoconstituents, the marker compound, I just mentioned that unless we make the phytoconstituents available at reasonable cost, till such time I don't think we'll be able to make really effective the analysis of it. Extraction technology. Now the extraction technology has certainly changed over a period of time, and today we are getting the more better extract rather than what it was maybe 10 years back or the 20 years back. Today we got more information about the chemical constituents which are present in the plant. According to the method of the extraction have been changed. The supercritical co-extraction has come, AAC has come, accelerated solvent extraction has come, more extraction methods have come, but FDA has still to recognize actually all this extraction method. In fact, the time has come that FDA must think about it and include them actually appropriately as per the candidate which is in process, so that we come out with a better extract in the market, and those are the ones which will be used for that. Clinical studies is the area where we started with it, but I think the lot need to be done actually to understand and to do the clinical evaluation of the clinical studies for our own product. And lastly and most importantly, whatever product we have, the traditional system, the time has come that we must change them to the modern form, because the current generation will not accept, or maybe after the next generation will not accept the form in a classical way in which it has been formulated today. What they want actually, the new form, the acceptable form, the modern form. So these are the various issues actually which the sector is battling about it. When we talk about the quality control, what is quality control? Now the quality, when we talk about the quality control, many companies, they say we have excellent quality control premises, where the others say that okay, we have reasonably well, others say okay, we are poor. What is requirement actually? The requirement, whenever we talk about any product for the healthcare, the mandatory requirement is that we must give a quality product, and this we take the oath at the time of getting into the profession. So quality, giving the quality product is not something which we enjoy the freedom, but it is an obligation on us that we must come out with a quality product whenever we talk about into the healthcare. Now, when we talk about the quality control, at what stage the quality control comes into the picture? Unlike in the allopathic medicine we have a paracetamol as a raw material, and the paracetamol actually has a final product in the form of a tablet or maybe a capsule or maybe a syrup. So only at the two stage the quality control comes into the picture. Unlike that, the herbal sector has the quality control at the various stages, and at every stage the quality control must set in. Unless it is set in, I don't think you can ensure the final quality of the product. And these are the various sectors actually, or the various channels at which the quality need to be checked. It starts from the sowing the seed, because unless you sow right seed, you will not get the right quality plant material. So the quality channel is very important here, and at every channel the attention must be paid. And if any channel fails into the process, ultimately is going to affect the quality of the final product. So this channel and every channel, I know that all the channels are not representing here, but at every channel, and the efforts must be made by the government, at every channel the quality control aspect must be incorporated, and not just incorporated, but it must be dealt with it. Then only we will have the final product which will have the proper quality. Now the importance of the analyzing the Ayurvedic product, why it is important to analyze the Ayurvedic product. Now the problems due to unidentified issues, we have many issues, we have no control on it, because of ultimately the manufacturer who gets the raw material in the form of the raw material, he has no control how it is being cultivated or whether it is in what condition it is obtained from the wild source. He has no control. What he is has his disposal only the external appearance of it. And on the basis of the external appearance, I don't think it will be possible to evaluate the quality of the plant material. So it is very essential that he must know. So the problem can be enormous, right from the sourcing to the processing level. So problems are enormous. At every level there are the problems. And these problems, unless we get into the quality control properly, these problems will go unheard, will go unnoticed, and eventually it will get incorporated into the final product. Now what is the requirement of the pharmacopoeia? We have three important requirements. One is identity, second one is the purity, and the third one is the content of the AC. When we talk about the identity, well, a lot of pharmacopoeia has already come to establish the identity. We still have some confusion in some cases, but yes, by incorporating the botanical name, I think that confusion has been, you know, been able to overcome to a great extent. So by mentioning now the vernacular name along with actually the botanical name, and thereafter of course the plant part, I think this has addressed to a great extent actually this requirement about the identity. But this is only identity about the plant material and its external form of it. What about the purity of it? This identity does not establish anything pertaining to the purity of it. When you talk about the purity, what do you mean by purity? Purity means does not the product alone the identity, but what else you are getting along with that. Whether the product is contaminated with the aflatoxin, whether the product is contaminated with the pesticides, because there are quite a few instances where the grower has not used the pesticide, but still he has found the contamination of the pesticide in his produce, because the neighboring farm was using the pesticide, and during the monsoon, during the water current actually, the pesticide which he has used in the neighboring farm has come to his farm, and the plant has absorbed those pesticides and eventually become the part of the plant. So look at this, what has happened. It is not the identity of the plant material, but the purity, because it should be free from the contaminant, whether it is a metal contaminant or whether it is the pesticide contaminant or something which does not represent the drug of it. And the third and the important thing actually is the content of the assay. When we talk about the assay, today I don't think we are confirming, we are only simply putting on the label actually, okay, we are used the Dalhousie or the berberis. We have no idea to what extent it should contain the berberine in that. We don't mention the berberine at all. And in market, I must tell you currently what is happening. In majority of the cases, the berberine has already been extracted from that. And the same berberis powder is put into the market for the further sale. Or for that matter, the clove oil. The clove oil is extracted by the supercritical fluid extraction. The same clove is put into the market. It satisfies both of your first two requirements, that identity, yes, it is the clove that is fully established. It also, also takes care of the second point, that purity, because it does not have any contaminant. But what about the content of the ASA? It fails there. So unless we get into that we must establish the standard that, okay, when we talk about the clove oil, it must contain 15% of the volatile oil, of which 90% is eugenol. Unless we enforce this, I don't think first two will really make any difference in the quality of it. So the time has come that... So along with identity and purity, what is more essential, that we must also have the content of the assay. Now please let me make very clear here, actually this assay, what I am talking about, it is not related to the biological assay. When I talked about it, that berberine not necessarily the berberine is an active constituent, but berberine certainly is a representative of the drug. So to that extent, you must establish the identity, purity and the content of the berberine in the sample, not necessarily for the biological purpose, but making sure that what we are using actually in the sample is the same with the proper content of the berberine in the sample. And unless we do that, we will be getting actually the exhaustive material and it will fail to give any therapeutic effect at the latter stage. Now, it's a complex, herbal is a complex field, so the factor which influence the quality, in fact some of the factors which I already told you on which we have no control. Now look at the factors further. Now the herbal mixture, herbal drug is usually a mixture of many constituents. Single herb itself is a mixture of many constituents. When we talk about the polyherbal, it is, you know, the whole thing gets further complexed. Okay? Each drug, in majority of the cases, I have not come across any drug which contains less than 20 or 25 ingredients. This is the complex mixture. So when we talk about the polyherbal preparation, even if you take the simplest Triphala Churna, which is a combination of three herbs, according to me, there has to be at least 70 to 80 ingredients in that. I know it's a very complex phenomena, and we cannot certainly get into the analysis of all these things. But yes, it's a complex mixture. Why we need to understand? Because we need to, at some stage, we need to lay down the quality standard. So though it is a complex, we cannot say that, okay, don't lay down because of the complex. Yes, there's a complexity, but we have to find out the appropriate solution for that. Second, the active principles in most of the cases are unknown. Well, we still have the unknown constituent, but at the same time, we have lot many known constituents as well. For example, as I know, other day I gave the example of the Rauhlphia. In 1942, the first constituent was isolated in the form of the reserpin. As of today, 40 more alkaloids have been identified from that. That does not mean that it does not have the 40 more. It may have 40 more constituents which as on today we are unable to identify because of the want of maybe instrumental methods of analysis, or maybe our extraction is not something sufficient. So there may be possibility of presenting 40 more phytoconstituents into the process. Well, that will come out maybe over a period of time. But what we have information today, as on today, that okay, Rauhlphia, Serpentina contains reserpine, now Azmarycin. These are the major constituents, and let's make use of them actually for the quality standards. Next, selective antical methods or reference compounds may not be available commercially. Well, this was the phenomena. Even today it is a phenomena that whatever reference compound you choose, it is quite likely that you may not get it. For example, vitafirinate, ashwagandha, you choose okay vitafirinate A as a marker compound, but availability is very poor because it is very expensive. 1 milligram or maybe 5 milligram will cost you 25,000. So certainly these are the problem associated with the field, and with the result actually there is need actually that more and more people should come out with this so that it becomes more feasible. Plant materials are chemically and naturally variable. This is bound to be remaining. Sensitivity of the natural origin will always have this variation being available in the nature. What we need to address actually, how we can reduce or minimize this variation. What we can do, we can decide our standards based upon that, okay, we will take the extract which will contain not less than 5% of the berberine. And that is how we will be able to minimize the natural variation when we actually use this part in our formulation. Chemo varieties and the chemo cultivars that will continue again variation, it will incorporate the variation. Source and quality of the raw materials are variable. Certainly something which is available from the central India and something which is available from the natural habitat may not be the same. But what we can control it at the latter stage, that we can certainly take some maybe a biomarker or a marker actually make it uniform and standardize the extract for that matter. Method of harvesting, drying, all other factors, whatever I laid down, those are the factors actually which will have the heavy impact on the quality of the product. Now when we talk about herbal raw material or for that matter finished product, what are the quality control measures? These I have laid down the quality control measures. Now every herbal product or the herbal formulation, it has to pass through the number of stages, battery of the parameters of the evaluation. Now this is very important because no single parameter will be able to establish its identity, purity in total sense. And that is the reason why we need to pass through the battery of the test. Well, it may not be every time, it may not be applicable, but certainly in some cases, you need to carry out more than 2-3 or sometimes more than 5 tests to establish the complete and the foolproof identity of that. Now to establish this, what we need to do actually is the analysis, and that is the major problem associated with it. We don't have still the laboratories who are geared up that. We don't have the methods what we need to analyze for. We don't have how to analyze for. All these things are really creating problem for us. What we need actually for this are good laboratory practices. Now the good laboratory practices certainly will address this issue, because this issue, this good laboratory practices addresses everything right from personnel to the method validation. Okay? Now the good laboratory practices, the principle of the good laboratory practices should be applied to the testing of Ayurvedic products to obtain the data on their properties and or their safety with respect to the human health or the environment. The good laboratory practices is concerned with the organization process and the conditions under which laboratory studies are planned, performed, monitored, recorded and are reported. So this will involve, this is just not only testing, but is the entire thing associated, right from managing the personnel, recruiting the personnel, establishing the laboratory, buying the instrument, validating the instrument, coming up with the SOPs for the analysis, testing protocol, all these will come under the good laboratory practices. Requirement of the GLP or the good laboratory practices. Now what does it need actually? It needs adequate facilities, trained personnel and approved procedures. Now the procedures, every often know, if we are in academic, we come out with the procedures, but those are the procedures which are applicable in a narrow sense. What we need to come out actually with the full procedures which are validated, which are reproducible, only those procedures need to be employed actually for the final analysis. Sampling process, what we need to, because you know, unlike, as I told you, allopathic raw material, in a one drug itself we get 50 bags which are of the variables, so the sampling is very important. Whatever sample we do, actually it must represent the complete lot of it. So the skill arises, number of samples need to be taken into consideration, which eventually must speak or represent the entire batch of it. Now the sample during transportation, there are chances that it may get desegregated, okay, and with the result, whatever sample you draw it, actually it may not represent the uniform sample. So the great amount of skill, we need to establish even SOP for the sampling, and then only your analysis will be of the will be carrying a proper sense. Unless you have the sampling in process properly, probably whatever analysis you may do, it will not again will be a proper thing. So the samples, sample inspecting and testing of the starting material, packaging materials, and intermediate bulk and the finished powder. So these are all the things which will be required for the GLP. Well, these are all the things which have been listed out and we need to follow that. I will go to the requirement of that. The crux of the requirement is this: when we talk about the GLP guidance, the checklist, what we need a person and the cleanliness. Personnel, those who are well trained to carry out the analysis. When we talk about the analysis, the personnel should be carried out. Well, there are different kinds of analysis. We have a chemical analysis, we have a biological analysis, we have a physical analysis, and for every analysis we have a different methods, different sort of different peoples which are adequately trained in that, so they can understand the problem associated with this. They can also understand in case of the results are not getting it, why they are not getting it. They should be able to know, it's not only not getting the result is important, but why they are not getting the result or how well we went wrong. The people should be able to judge that. Unless they are able to judge that, probably will not be able to have the proper analysis being performed. So the premises, cleanliness and the person is very important. Equipment and the instrument. Most of the most of the laboratory I have seen, they purchase the instrument and thereafter they keep using it for over a period of time without validating it or without checking that whether the instrument has still continuing its own property or involves a sensitivity. Over a period of time, instrument do lose a sensitivity. In fact, the HPLC, the lifespan of a lamp is around 1,000 hours, but still I have seen people continue thereafter. It affects the sensitivity of that, but we still interpret the result, and there is a need actually that every often these instruments must be validated with a standard compound. So there is a need for that. So the equipment, whatever we use it, or the instrument, whatever we use it, they should be they should be calibrated, they should be actually validated every often or on the periodic basis. Standards, reagent, the control, many times your test failed because of the want of the proper reagent. The reagents are not proper. Certain reagents need to be freshly prepared. Certain reagents need to be kept in a proper. In fact, other day I was showing the test actually on the Lieberman Bucard test. The important requirement of that, the test must be carried out in an absolutely dry test tube. Even the slight moisture which is present in the test tube, you not get the test for that. So these are all the things actually which must be recorded and which must be scrupulously followed to that. And unless we do that, I don't think we'll be able to do the proper justice to the analysis. Sampling, I think I'll just explain to you, product specification. Now when you make product, you make a specification in such a way that actually, okay, in fact, it won't be very narrow by which every often you have a problem, but at the same time, it should not be too broader by which you can show the pH between, let's say between 4 to 10. Well, that is not the correct SOP or the correct specification. You need to give it in something reasonable. At the same time, considering the natural variation, this limit need not be so precisely narrow as that of the allopathic medicine. We need to give a little broader margins actually to accommodate the product and the variation which exists in the sector. But certainly we need to give the some, no, maybe in that not very broad, but certainly a broader as compared to the, you know, as compared to the, what about the allopathic part, but certainly not very broad actually by which everything that can know. Like for example, ash value, you know, it is like this, it should be between 8 to 15. I think it is too big a limit actually. So for that, certainly we need to narrow down this further, then only there will be more uniformity in the formulation. Testing procedures must be, in fact, testing procedure, as I told you, every raw material, okay, fine, there can be a, you know, common testing procedure. But when we talk about the formulation, I don't think we can have the common or the, you know, the common testing procedure. Each formulation, and for in that formulation, each ingredient will need a separate testing procedure. And for that, it must be established that it should be able to, I think while developing the procedure, people should undertake all the parameter associated validation, spiking also that, okay, whether the method is exclusive or not. Unless we do that, I don't think we'll be able to do the justice to that. Record of the analysis, many times I have seen in the industry also, and including in the academy, that many times we don't record what we are doing it. And it is very essential when we carry out, whether it is method development or that, you know, testing procedure development, and thereafter the actual testing, at every step we must maintain proper record. Later on, even if you fail it, certainly this record will help you actually to understand where we went wrong. Many times, since we don't keep record, because somebody, and many times what happens during procedure, I have seen actually the personnel get changed. Some procedure which need to be carried out over a period of time. For example, it has been taken over by the other person, and unless for the want of proper record, it will not get passed on properly. And for that, the record keeping is very essential. Proper record keeping is very essential. Otherwise, it will give the wrong or the erroneous result. And that is what the documentation, whatever we do ultimately, it must be properly documented, not just for that particular procedure, but it will also help you in future whenever you set the procedures for the other formulation, when you come across the similar kind of the ingredients. Standardization, I think a lot has been talked about it, and I'm sure we have been talking about it, standardization, for a long time. But I must tell you, standardization, the evaluation, these two are separate issues. When we talk about the standardization of the raw material, in fact, I am associated with the standardization of the raw material, where we take normally the three different parts, but from the three different locations. And we also try to get it as many samples as one from the different locations and carry out the evaluation so that we know the variation which is taking place from one region to the other region. And thereafter, we come out with the narrow limit actually by which we see a situation where practically those who are using the genuine sample, they must come into that narrow limit whichever we have specified. So that is what the standardization, and it is just not one-time evaluation. You cannot base your limit on doing the one-time analysis. Okay, you need to carry out more samples, make sure that which is the lowest, which is the highest, and how you can minimize this. This such a long or such a big actually gap, and bring it to the narrow gap by narrow margin, and then it will be a standardization. One time is an evaluation. Analytical methodology, in the same sequence I'll put it actually, many times we carry out. I'll give the example, 1955 the IP started. Thereafter we have a 1966, 1985, 1995, 2007 and 2010. In the first IP it was only gravimetry. Later on 1966 it was stratigraphy. In 1985 most of them they switched over to the UV analysis. 2007 and 2010 we have a HPLC. So look at the change which has taken place from the gravimetry to HPLC. I am sure down the line 20 years we'll have something else coming out of it. Okay, and this is what the journey is going on. And with the result actually today, what allopath is following it for every analysis, it is only the HPLC which has been used, because that is the instrument, small quantity you need actually, and give the high precision result. And the time has come that the Ayurvedic fraternity and the herbal sector, wherever possible, must get into the HPLC analysis, because yes, it is reproducible, small quantity, you'll need just small quantity, and you'll get a more accurate picture over other methods like calorimetry or maybe a tritrimetry. Okay, I have seen that the case actually of hydroxy citric acid, where the hydroxy citric acid was sold in terms of total acid content rather than hydroxy citric acid content, and the total mixture was contributing more pure citric, and the tartaric acid was more in that, and only 5% was the hydroxy citric acid, when the therapeutic ingredient was only hydroxy citric acid. Okay, and since HPLC was not followed, it was sold only on the total acid content in terms of hydroxy citric acid. So the active were 5%, but was wrongly denoted to be as 85% or 75%. So this is what will be able to overcome actually by getting into the more, you know, the accurate, more pinpoint, only that particular ingredient you can analyze by the HPLC. So that is about adopting the modern methods of the analysis over actually the tradition of the old methods. This is what one need to do. Analytical methodology, in fact, I will request once again all those who are associated with the field to change it over, use phytochemical markers for the evaluation. Even if those are not biologically active, use phytochemical markers, because it will speak. Like when we talk about sample, when we take from the 500 or the 200 bags of one sample or the 5 sample, what does it indicate? We are not analyzing all the 500 bags, but these 3 bags or 3 sample, what we take it actually, these 3 sample represent the entire lot of it. Likewise, you take this phytochemical marker as an indicative of the strength of the lot or the purity of the lot. So this biomarker should be used, such the marker should be used not as for the biological activity, but to represent the entire drug, analysis of the entire drug, and switch it over from this routine analysis of maybe a titrimetry or gravimetry, or for that matter even thermometry, to the HPLC using marker compound. And many cases, same marker compound is also acting as a biomarker compound. So it will be more appropriate to switch it over to the HPLC related analysis using phytochemical reference standard. Methods, whatever the methods we are using it actually, make sure that we use the validated methods, procedures, SOP, prepare SOP, whatever, and relook at the SOPs, because quite likely because new knowledge will come in and you need to relook at your SOPs and change it accordingly. It is not that you made the SOP 2 years back and you continue with the same SOP. No, because a lot of things are changing, instrument things are changing, reagents are changing, new analytical methods are coming up. So keep looking at it every often, relook at your processes, whatever you have laid down, relook at them, bring appropriate changes, and then continue. Well, protocol for the analysis of the herbal drugs. Towards end, I have taken one statistical study, and in that connection, I have compared this 5 market preparation, wherein actually all these preparations are made for the cough, relieving the cough, and cough. These are all the cough syrup which are made for the relieving the cough syrup, cough. And I have listed all the ingredients which have been incorporated by the different companies. And in all, there are almost 30 different ingredients which have been put by the individual companies. 30 all collectively together. Out of that, when I compared it, actually only 5 of them are something which is matching, which is uniformly been used in all the formulation. Rest 25 are differing from company to company. What does this indicate? I have drawn an inference that okay, these 5 are something which are essential to analyze to begin with it first. These 5 are essential. Okay, so let us get into the analysis of these 5 first. I know it is very difficult to analyze all the 30 ingredients which are put into the formulation. Very difficult, practically impossible. But the time has come that we must analyze at least these 5 ingredients which are common. And I will also request to those who are into the segment to make sure that why don't you let down the minimum concentration of these 5 herbs which are essential. I feel essential because they are repetitive in all the formulation. Let down their minimum quantity. Then it becomes easier actually to analyze the bases. And for example, in this formulation, the Vasaka is present actually, which is up to the quantity differs from 25 milligram to 200 milligram. So certainly you can analyze Vasaka, but certainly you cannot analyze with a uniform quantity, because one formulation contains 25 milligram per 5 ml, while the other contains 200 milligram per 5 ml. So certainly it will be more appropriate to have the uniform quantity, or maybe some standard by which you can say, okay, whenever you come out with the cough syrup, it should at least contain 100 milligram of the Vasaka in that. Then it becomes, and analysis will become much more easier, and probably more people will be encouraged to get into the analytical process for the analysis of that. That's it. Thank you very much.